Welcome back, friends. In this video tutorial, we'll be talking about the introductory part of Salmonella species. Now, Salmonella species is a type of gram-negative bacteria. Okay, and this is again of a very significant in clinical microbiology because Salmonella can cause several different types of enteric diseases. Okay, different kinds of colitis, gastroenteritis, and all these things. So that's why for the systemic disease, if you're talking about systemic disease, most renowned microorganisms or most renowned pathogen in that section of the systemic disease is this Salmonella, because E. coli can cause infections, but not all the strains of E. coli causes infection. But Salmonella is really pathogenic in many aspects. Okay. And usually most of the Salmonella infections that we'll be talking about are of foodborne infections. In fact, in the United States, among all the foodborne infections, Salmonella is a causative agent for the foodborne infection above 30%. Right? So we can see that Salmonella is playing a huge role in the pathogenesis in foodborne infections. So we need to study Salmonella very carefully so that we can handle these foodborne infections and low down the effect of foodborne infections. And let's talk about the properties of Salmonella. As I've told you before, that Salmonella is a gram-negative bacteria. So let me write down the properties. They are gram-negative kind of bacteria. And they are short rods. They're short rods. So let me write again a kind of similar structure like E. coli. They are also short rods. And these are the short rods. And they are having flagella, but again, so they are having mobility. So motile using flagella. Okay. But the way they differ from the E. coli is that E. coli can have they can ferment lactose, but Salmonella cannot ferment lactose. Instead, Salmonella can ferment glucose. But not lactose. So they are eventually lac minus, right? As we have known, they are lac minus kind of bacteria. Now E. coli can ferment glucose as well as they can ferment lactose. So E. coli are lac plus or lac positive type of bacteria. So these are the difference. And except for that, these Salmonella species are catalase positive. So they are catalase, which is a chemical identification step. This catalase positive, but they are oxidase negative, right? These two things are also important. And we can also grow this Salmonella on McConkie agar plate. So grow on McConkie agar. McConkie agar. Now in McConkie agar is a specific type of media, and in this particular media, so let me draw this McConkie agar for you. So if this is the McConkie agar, how we can look at it? If we look at here, we are going to find our colony. So let me color it a little bit. Let's say this. Okay. So let's say here it is. So this is, say, the McConkie agar. Let's say this is the McConkie agar. Okay. Let's say here it is the McConkie agar. Then this McConkie agar, we are going to find our colonies red in color, red or purple in color, like that. Right? So simply its colonies, like, it will form like that. This kind of colonies can be formed in McConkie agar. And this is true for also E. coli. So we can see there are many similarities between this Salmonella and E. coli in properties, but they are differing in this lactose fermenting ability. Right? So that's the important and uniqueness. And another uniqueness about the Salmonella, we have talked about that most of the Salmonella infection, so they cause gastroenteritis. Right? And obviously different colitis and all these GI tract infections. In all these cases, they are foodborne. So most of these infections are foodborne infections. Right? And they are transferred via the contaminated food. Okay. So they are transferred via the contaminated food. And another important ability of the salmonella is to generate H2S or hydrogen sulfide. That's another unique point. So if we are talking about an amino acid, let's talk about this particular amino acid. Let's say amino acid with sulfur, like cysteine. So let's say cysteine. So if it degrades the cysteine, which is having sulfur, right? In this case, it will degrade this cysteine amino acid, and it can generate hydrogen sulfide. Now this hydrogen sulfide gas smells like rotten eggs, right? So we can see the presence of this salmonella in many cases. It is a smell like rotten egg. And this salmonella infections are mostly, I've talked about that they are foodborne, but especially they are of poultry origin. That means the meat, poultry meat as well as eggs. We need to be very careful about choosing them, and we need to cook them properly before eating. So these are the different ways of salmonella infections and salmonella properties. Now salmonella, the division or the classification of salmonella is a kind of difficult job throughout the time, because previously there are several groups of salmonella, several species and strains of salmonella. People have a very hard time to figure out which strain is need to put in which group. But nowadays they put all the strains of salmonella in one major species. So all the strains, so let me write all strain in one species, in one, and that particular species is called Salmonella enterica. So this is going to be the newest strain, which is containing all the different strains of Salmonella. Okay, so that in this particular genus, actually they are having, it is consisting of approximately over 2500 serotypes. 2500 serotypes approximately there. Okay, so that's it, and I hope that's helpful. Thank you. Okay guys, so we have already talked about the introductory video about Salmonella. Now in this case we'll be talking about the infectivity or infection. So we'll be talking about infection by Salmonella. Now usually the infectivity caused by Salmonella is via food. So it's via food. So it's a kind of foodborne infections, right? It's a kind of foodborne infections we'll be talking. In all these cases, we know that especially the poultry food, the poultry meat as well as the egg can contain the Salmonella pathogen, and they can cause severe kind of symptoms, and we'll be talking about two major of them. So two major types of symptoms they are causing. One is the gastroenteritis. So let me like, one is the gastroenteritis. Sorry, one is gastroenteritis. And another one is, so let me write the another one. Another one is enteric fever or typhoid fever. Enteric, or let me write, or it is also called as typhoid fever. So these are the two different types of disease that they usually cause. Now, in the first kind of the gastroenteritis, this is a kind of localized disease, okay, and also it is called as salmonellosis, okay, this is called as salmonellosis, but they are among the gastroenteritis, okay. So anyways, now in this case, this particular type of disease is caused by the serotype called Salmonella enteriditis. So let me write, this is caused by Salmonella enteriditis. This is called Salmonella enteriditis, okay. And also it can also be caused by Salmonella typhimurium, Salmonella typhimurium, murium, okay. So it can be caused by these two kind of serotypes. So all of them are serotypes. Remember, because all of the Salmonella species are entered into the Salmonella enteritica, particular type of species. So this Salmonella enteriditis or Salmonella typhimurium, they are different serotypes actually. They are serotypes of Salmonella species, okay, or serotypes of Salmonella enterica. Okay, and in this case, this kind of disease is characterized by nausea, vomiting, and diarrhea. Obviously, bloody diarrhea is related, sometimes of watery diarrhea, which develop usually within the 48 hours of injection of the contaminated food or water. So I may write, it's not only food, but also can be transferred via water also, right? So we need to be known this fact. Okay. So it's and after this infection is set place, it can be treated. It can our normal immune system can go against it, but it is very very important because it is very important that our gut microflora remains constant, because otherwise if our gut microflora is getting devastated, in those conditions this particular type of bacteria will thrive, because our gut microflora like Escherichia coli and other beneficial organisms, if they suppressed due to some extent, in those cases they can cause diseases. Okay, and the second kind of disease they usually cause is enteric fever, or which is also called as typhoid fever. In this case, this is severe and life-threatening, and simply it is also denoted by illness and by fever and headache, abdominal cramp, and all these things. And it can also include some non-specific symptoms like sweats, vomiting, cough, and either diarrhea and all these things. Now for the incubation period, in this case the incubation period usually resists, or it continues, the incubation period usually continues from 5 to 21 days. So we can see this is pretty long day for this kind of infection, for the typhoid infection, right? And it is related with high fever, headache. Also related with headache. Okay. And vomiting, abdominal cramp, and all these things. Okay. And rest of the things like that. So in both these cases of gastroenteritis and enteric fever, there is a use of antigenic method, which is called a pathogenesis in this case, which are responsible for this particular fact. Okay. And we'll be seeing each of this detail in our pathogenesis video, but now in this case, we'll be knowing that they can use their flagella, and also they are having their pathogenic regions like their outer membrane or cell membrane to adhere to the host cell and can infect us. Okay, so in many aspects they are similar like the Escherichia coli, but they are different in some aspects. We've already talked about it. So that's it about the infection. In the future video, we'll be talking about the pathogenesis in detail. Welcome guys, in the previous video we have talked about the infectivity about Salmonella species. Now in this video we'll be talking about their pathogenesis, so their pathogenesis properties, pathogenesis. Okay, now Salmonella can cause infection using different mediation or Salmonella toxin. There are some kind of toxin that they can use for causing the disease, and also they cause the disease by secreting some antigenic layers outside, right? Because they are gram negative, they are also having the LPS layer, or LPS, remember LPS or lipopolysaccharide layer. So the lipopolysaccharide layer they are processing, this is endotoxin, right? And we have talked before that whatever type of enteric disease we are seeing, most of those diseases are caused due to the secretion of endotoxin inside. Now this endotoxin again can be released by this Salmonella typhi or Salmonella typhi murium and all these things. Now this LPS layer is consisting of another antigen, which is called O antigen, that can be antigenic also, right? So definitely they are they can cause disease, but they are also antigenic. Now as they are antigenic in nature, they can trigger our immune system cells. So they can trigger immune system. Now as they can trigger our immune system cells like macrophages, like neutrophils and all those killer cells, phagocytic cells, they will come and try to engulf this bacteria. Now what they want is this particular mechanism, that our immune system cell will catch them and travel from one place to another place. Now remember, this is a very very clever strategy. We have already discussed this strategy earlier in some other kind of bacteria, that usually there is a process for the pathogenesis of bacteria. You must do two important things. One is escaping immune system, and second one, so let me write, one is escaping immune system. So always I write this part, escaping immune system or escaping host immunity, escaping host immunity. This is the first important thing that you must do. And another important thing is also there, and that is destruction of the host cell. Destruction of host. Destruction of host cell. So both these things are required for a successful infection. Now, in this case of Salmonella species, what they are doing, they are applying one particular process and one particular strategy. That one particular strategy can combine both these effects all together. So in this case, what they are doing, that they are taking our immune cells like macrophage, our immune cells like neutrophils, especially the immune cells like macrophage, to hide themselves inside. So as they are hiding inside macrophages, because macrophage can engulf them, now they can hide inside. Hiding inside of macrophage provide them this particular thing, which is escaping of immunity. And second thing also, destruction of the host cell, because they can be transferred from one place to another place. Because these macrophage cells, they can be stayed in different tissues like submucosal layer, epithelial, endothelial tissues. So they can be transferred from one place to another place. Or sometimes they can also be released into the bloodstream. So they can be transferred. Even they can reach a bloodstream, they can be transferred from one place to another place, from one tissue to another tissue. And that is their actual goal. So let us look at the pathogenesis scheme. Now, before understanding this pathogenesis scheme in detail, you must understand the intestinal lining. You must know the intestinal lining. So let me draw the intestinal lining. Intestinal cell lining. Now, intestinal cell lining, what is this lining is telling us? So let me write cell lining. Now, this intestinal lining, we are having this intestinal cells. So epithelial cells, for example, epithelial cells. So let me draw the epithelial cells for you. So these are the microvilli that is coming out from the epithelial cells, lot of microvilli, because it will give us the higher surface area, right? Because we need to absorb nutrients from this particular region. So here we go. These are the cells. These are the different cells, for example, right? So these are the cells and placing, and microvilli is coming out and everything is going far, right? In this case, what will be going on is that Salmonella enters, and let's say this is the Salmonella. So Salmonella enters and they are attached to, so let me change the color. In this case, they are attached to a particular kind of villi. Let's say this one. So Salmonella attached to a particular villi like this. Now, as it is attached there, they will be engulfed. Now, Salmonella is engulfed inside of this epithelia. Now, normally the intestinal lining is made up with this epithelial cell. So let me write, this is epithelial cell, and there will be endothelial cell somewhere. But before that, right after the epithelial cell, what we are having another layer, and that is called submucosa. So let me write it. This layer is called submucosa. Submucosa. Okay. So the submucosa layer is also there. Now, as the Salmonella bacteria enters and they are engulfed via the endocytosis pathway. So, as a result of the endocytosis, what we can see here are the endocytic vesicles. And inside these endocytic vesicles, we are having the Salmonella bacteria. So here we go. The Salmonella is inside. Now, once it is entered inside these epithelial cells, then they can be transferred into submucosa. And we know that the submucosa is rich in immune system cells. It is rich in immune system. For example, there is this macrophage sitting there. So let me change the color here. There is macrophage which is just sitting here to engulf the foreign pathogen. So this is the macrophage. Remember the scary guy. The macrophage is sitting here. This is macrophage which is sitting in this submucosal layer. Now, as this Salmonella enters inside this epithelial cell, then they will be transferred into the submucosa. And during this transfer inside the submucosa, this macrophage will start to engulf this Salmonella inside. So now let's say here it is the Salmonella inside the macrophage, and let me draw the nucleus of macrophage. Let's say here it is the nucleus of macrophage, and we are having this Salmonella inside. So if I make more and more macrophages like that, so let's say smaller macrophage like this, all of this macrophage, they can engulf and hold on to many different Salmonella. So all of these macrophage having their own nucleus, and they are engulfing this Salmonella. So Salmonella is coming inside now. So here it is, the salmonella is keeping inside. So now remember, the strategy of salmonella infection is that they will be hiding inside these macrophage cells, right? So hiding is the strategy. So this, whenever this salmonella cells entering inside the submucosa, it is achieving this hiding task. Now the rest of the task is to propagate. Now the second task is to propagate from one place to another place. So propagation is required now. And for this propagation, what we can see, this macrophage will help them to propagate from one place to another place, because this macrophage will make a sooner a colony or a bunch of macrophages, and then they can be transferred from one place to another place through or via bloodstream. And the process here they utilize is called, the reticuloendothelial system. So let me write, it is called the reticuloendothelial system. Reticuloendothelial system. Okay. Now in this reticuloendothelial system, what do you mean by this reticuloendothelial system? It is from the reticuloendocytes. So reticuloendothelial cells. Right. So the term comes from this reticuloendothelial cells, and these reticuloendothelial cells are a kind of precursor cells. So let me write, they are a kind of precursor cells present in bone marrow. So they are precursor cells in bone marrow, right? BM means bone marrow. So they are a precursor cell present in bone marrow. Now as they are matured, they are giving rise to monocytes. So let me write, they are giving rise to monocyte. Now remember, monocytes are the cells which are patrolling in bloodstream, but now some of those monocytes which are entering into the tissue, remember, they entered into the tissue, we will be calling them as macrophages. We'll be calling them as macrophage. So here comes the role of macrophage, right? So from where macrophage is originated? From monocyte. And monocyte, the precursor cell of monocyte is reticuloendothelial cells. So the system by which the salmonella can move from one place to another place is via the construction or an array of macrophages engulfing that salmonella inside, and those total construction of macrophage with salmonella is called the reticuloendothelial system, right? So this reticuloendothelial system will transfer them from one place to another place, and especially they are transferring them from any kind of submucosal tissue in gut. So I forget to mention here, in this gastrointestinal lining we are talking about this particular thing, and the outside region here, it is consisting of gut. So it is the endothelial lumen, right? So it's a lumen of gut. So let me write here, it was a lumen of gut, right? So as we know, the infection starts there, and after the infectivity it will move from this submucosa into most of the time they enters into liver. Now, as they are entering into liver, they cause several kinds of symptoms. And what are the symptoms? The symptoms are lymphoid hyperplasia and hypertrophy. So, lymphoid hyperplasia, hyperplasia, and also hypertrophy. Right? Both these things are caused after the infection set place and it is bring inside the liver, right? Now from there they can re-enter into our gut system. So they can re-enter, so let me write, from here it can re-enter, or it can mix, sorry, re-enter or remixed with bowel, right? And then it can be coming out from stool, and it can cause diarrhea, headache, coughing, abdominal cramps, and all these different symptoms that we have already talked about, right? So this is the mode of action of salmonella pathogenesis. Now you can see here, in salmonella pathogenesis there are sequential events, like the attack in the intestinal lining, then the spreading from intestinal lining into liver, and then finally destroying different organs and different regions. So all these things, right? Now in this total system, It will take some time. So it will take some time. So it's a time consuming strategy, but it's a very, very dangerous strategy. So that's what we have seen in some case of this Salmonella infection. There are times like 5 to 21 days. Remember, in typhoid, there are also incubation period of 5 to 21 days because it requires that amount of time for Salmonella to provide and spread enormous infection. But still, when they provide this infection, it will be difficult for us to go against them. But there are strategies, and we'll be discussing those strategies in the later video. Thank you. Okay, guys, so we have been talking about Salmonella species. We have seen the introduction, infection, as well as we have discussed about the Salmonella pathogenesis processes. Now, in this video, we'll be talking about Salmonella treatment. So we'll be talking about treatment. Now, the important thing about Salmonella treatment, in fact, important thing about all the other enteric infections, which eventually results in gastroenteritis, usually won't require any kind of antibiotic treatment. Usually, so antibiotic treatment usually is not required. But what we require in all these cases, is good personal hygiene. So it's obviously prevention is better. Prevention is really, really better for this case. So in this case of prevention, what we require handling of food properly. Right, and the second important thing we need to look for is sewage disposal and perfect or correctly mannered sewage disposal. This is also required, and also personal hygiene. Okay, so these are the three major things that are required for any kind of gastroenteritis, because here we are talking about the agents causing gastroenteritis. So gastroenteritis. Okay, so in any kind of gastroenteritis, you generally don't require much more attention using antibiotics. Simply these prevention measures help us. But if it is doing any kind of harm, we are seeing that infection has become severe and severe, in those cases we can use some kind of antibiotics. We can use some antibiotics, and on those antibiotics that we can use, simply one of the example is ceftriaxone and also ciprofloxacin. Okay, so these are the two important antibiotics that we can use to treat Salmonella infection, especially Salmonella typhi infections. Okay, using ceftriaxone, which is a third generation cephalosporin. So it's actually third generation cephalosporin. Okay, and ciprofloxacin, we all know, it's a kind of fluoroquinolone, I guess. Okay, so these are the antibodies that you can use, but remember these three things: handling of food, you should be well, and obviously sewage disposal should be perfect, and personal hygiene definitely required, because most of this kind of gastroenteritis infections occur in third world countries or the developing countries. In those cases, they are poor hygiene, and obviously sewage problems and a sanitary system is not good. So, you know, due to all these different reasons, so actually these diseases are also related with socio-economical conditions. So you need to take care of all these things first, because it will give us healthy nation, right? So for a healthy nation, you should maintain all these necessary facts as a prevention measure in all kind of gastroenteritis, including the gastroenteritis caused by Salmonella species. So that's about the treatment, and I hope that's helpful. Thank you.